So this morning, we are in Matthew 17. We're going to start in verse 14. My sermon title this morning, Faith in Christ, the Mountain Mover. Verse 14, and when they were come to the multitude, there came to him a certain man kneeling down to him and saying, Lord, have mercy on my son, for he is lunatic and sore vexed. For oftentimes he falleth into the fire and oft into the water. And I brought him to thy disciples, and they could not cure him. Then Jesus answered and said, O faithless and perverse generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I suffer you? Bring him hither to me. And Jesus rebuked the devil, and he departed out of him. And the child was cured from that very hour. Then came the disciples to Jesus apart and said, Why could not we cast him out? And Jesus said unto them, Because of your unbelief. For verily I say unto you, if ye have faith as a grain of mustard seed, ye shall say unto this mountain, Remove hence to yonder place, and it shall remove, and nothing shall be impossible unto you. Howbeit this kind goeth not out, but by prayer and fasting. And while they abode in Galilee, Jesus said unto them, The Son of Man shall be betrayed into the hands of men, and they shall kill him, and the third day he shall be raised again. And they were exceeding sorry. This passage about the healing of the demoniac boy comes between the passage of the Mount of Transfiguration, in which Jesus went up into a high mountain and was transfigured before their eyes, and they saw him in all of his glory and his majesty. They saw him as God, not merely as the Son of Man, but as the Son of God. And then as they come down from the mountain, apparently the other nine disciples have been still down with the multitudes. And while Jesus was away, this man brings his son to them, and all he knows is his son has some serious problems. In fact, he refers to him as lunatic. And you notice in English, the word luna, like we get our word lunar, is in this word. And that's because what the man literally says is he's saying, my son is moonstruck. In fact, the Greek word is totally different, but it also has the Greek word for moon in it. And he says, so the Greek word is means to be moonstruck, crazy, or be a lunatic. So here comes this man, and he says, my son is crazy, and I brought him to your disciples, and your disciples couldn't do anything about it. He knows this kid isn't normal. He may or may not know the cause. We know the cause. The cause was this child was under the influence of a fallen angel, a demon, another spirit. Whether or not he knew the cause or not, he didn't know. All he knew is his son has serious problems. Oftentimes he falls into the fire, he falls into the water, and it appears to have some relationship to the moon, but he doesn't know necessarily why. Maybe he does, maybe he knows it has to do with demonic powers. But in any case, the disciples are not able to cast out the demon when they attempt to. And so we discover that this child is not normal, and the disciples are unable to deal with it. So they bring him to Jesus. The three that were on the mountaintop with Jesus weren't there, but they're there with him now. And we may think that the point of this passage, the biggest point, is to have faith in faith. If you simply have enough faith, you can move mountains. If you simply have enough faith, you can cast out demons. If you have enough faith, you can heal the sick. And that is an aspect of this passage, because Jesus says it, that it's because of their unbelief that they're unable to cast out the evil spirit. But I would urge you that the main point of this passage is that without Christ, we can do nothing. Without Christ, we can do nothing. Jesus is away on the mountaintop, and they cannot cast out the demon. Jesus comes and he says, bring the child to me. In John 15:5, Jesus said, I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth in me and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without me ye can do nothing. The branch is totally, utterly dependent upon the root in the vine. And Jesus says, I am the vine. I am the source. I am the power. I am the ability. I have the ability to do these things. And if you are in me and in my will, you can do them too. But without me, you can do nothing. Then the Apostle Paul in Philippians 4:12, listen to what he says. He says, I know both how to be abased, and I know how to abound. Everywhere in all things, I am instructed both to be full and to be hungry, both to abound and to suffer need. I can do all things through Christ, which strengthens me. Paul says, I can do anything through Christ who strengthens me. And yet, I've suffered hunger. I've been wealthy, I've been poor. I've been sick, I've been healthy. I faced all kinds of dilemmas, but I know this, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Now, why do I point that out? Because some people want the object of your faith to be in faith. And they'll say, you know what, if you can get the right formula and you can believe enough and say the right things or have enough power of faith, you'll never suffer again. You can believe for that shiny new car. You can believe for that big house and the place that you want to live. You can believe for more money and wealth. And faith then becomes a tool to get all of our wants and all of our desires. But Paul says, you know what? I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. And yet, he says, I've been poor, I've been hungry, I've been in need. But I'm able to face these things because I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. Now, if it was left up to Paul's flesh, he'd probably just say, wow, this is great. I've got the power of faith. I'm just going to heal people all day long, and I'm going to believe for, you know, I'm going to preach the gospel from a mansion, right? And yet, Paul seemed to not see any conflict at all between his being poor at times and yet also his knowledge that he can do all things through Christ who strengthens him. So the point of the sermon this morning is our faith is not merely to be in faith, but our faith is to be in Christ, who is the mountain mover. He is the one, Colossians 1 reveals us, that spoke the worlds into existence. He is the one who is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And the Lord who saves us is the Lord who has the power to heal us, to deliver us, to comfort us, to lead us, to guide us, to do His will in our life. Now let's look at these verses again. Let's look at verses 14 to 16. It says, when they were come to the multitude, there came to him a certain man, kneeling down to him and saying, Lord, have mercy on my son, for he is lunatic and sore vexed. For oftentimes he falleth into the fire and oft into the water. And I brought him to thy disciples, and they could not cure him. Okay, so we have the immediate dilemma. The dilemma is this child is not normal, and he says that he is a lunatic. Now, in verse 17, we come to dilemma number two. Then Jesus answered and said, O faithless and perverse generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I suffer you? Bring him hither to me. So dilemma number one is we've got this kid, and he's not normal. Something's wrong with him. Dilemma number two is the disciples cannot cast him out. Now here's a bit of a surprise. Jesus basically says the disciples aren't normal either. Now we may not, it's typical to not have this faith to move mountains. It's typical not to be able to cast out demons. That's a typical problem, but you know what? It's actually an abnormality. Faith is normal. Doubt and disbelief is an abnormality. And Jesus says, he calls them in verse 17, he calls them a faithless and perverse generation. Faithless and perverse. Now, this word perverse is interesting. Diastrepho in Greek. It means corrupt, perverse, distorted, to distort. Literally, it means to distort. If you've got a piece of metal, and you take that piece of metal and you bend it, and then you try to bend it back straight again. Have you ever noticed you can't do it? Solomon mentioned this, says, can that which is crooked be made straight? Once you bend that piece of metal, it has become crooked, and you try to get it straight, but it's actually been altered, and it's molecular. It's been altered in its structure, and as much as you try, you can't get it straight again. Now, you can melt down that piece of metal, re-pour it, but when you bend it, it alters it in such a way. It is perverted. It is crooked. It is deviated from its original set, and it can't be put back again. And that's the word that Jesus is using here. He says, you faithless and perverted or crooked generation. Doubt and disbelief are typical because we're sinful and we're fallen. Adam and Eve didn't have doubt and disbelief. Faith was natural to them. But since sin came into the world, we struggle with doubt and disbelief. But doubt and disbelief is an abnormality. The normal thing is to believe that the Creator of all things can do all things. The normal thing is to believe that the one who came and died for us while we were yet sinners loves us, wants to direct us, and care for us. We first need to realize that doubt and disbelief is an abnormality. It is the result of sin. It is typical. It's so typical, it's universal. But it's not normal. To doubt the Word of God, to doubt God's character, to doubt God's ability is an abnormality. It is sin. When we doubt God, we are questioning His honesty or His capability. That's not normal. And yet, it's typical, including for us as believers. It's our natural bent, if you will, our unnatural bent is doubt and disbelief. And Jesus reproves them for their lack of faith. And He says it's the result of crookedness. Now, Jesus asks two questions after He diagnoses that the first problem is this kid ain't normal. The second problem is the disciples aren't normal. And He asks two questions. He asks, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I be patient with you? I actually think these two questions are really the ones that should probably get the most focus in this passage. What comes next is the part that really hits us between the eyes. But it's very easy to gloss over this. How long shall I be with you? Now notice what verse we landed on at the end. Skip on down to the end of what we read real quick and look at verse 22 and 23. It says, while they stood, abode in Galilee, Jesus said unto them, the Son of Man shall be betrayed into the hands of men, and they shall kill him, and the third day he shall be raised again. And they were exceeding sorry. Why were they sorry? Why were they sorry? They just heard Him say, I'm going to die. But that's all they heard Him say. The only thing the disciples hear Him say at the end of the passage is, we're going to Jerusalem, I'm going to be betrayed and handed into evil men, and I'm going to be crucified. But He doesn't stop there, does He? He says, and I shall be raised again the third day. It's very interesting how Jesus says this. He actually doesn't say it the way I refuse it. He doesn't say, I am going to Jerusalem and I will be betrayed. But he speaks of Himself in the third person. He says, the Son of Man. Why does He do this? Why does He say, the Son of Man? Why doesn't He say, hey, we're going to Jerusalem, and I'm going to be handed over, betrayed, and crucified, and raised again the third day? He doesn't. He says, the Son of Man. Why does He do that? Well, the reason He does that is because the Son of Man is a reference to various prophecies. And what He's saying is, this is prophesied. This is the will of God. I've got suffering in my future, and it was ordained for me. The God that ordains all things and knows all things, He has ordained that I go to Jerusalem. It's been prophesied that the Son of Man will be crucified for the sins of His people, that He will be buried in a rich man's tomb, that He will rise again the third day. It's been prophesied ahead of time. So when He says the Son of Man, what He's saying is, guys, there is a will that has been revealed in the Word of God. It is said this will happen. It's going to happen. And they are sorry. They are upset because they're saying, uh-oh, we're going to be left alone. And without him, we can do nothing. Without Christ, we're powerless. Without Christ, we can't cast out the demon. Without Christ, we can't do the miracles. And all they're hearing is, I'm going to be taken from you. But Jesus doesn't stop there. He says, on the third day, I will rise again. And listen to what he says at the end of Mark. It says, so then after the Lord had spoken unto them, he was received up into heaven and sat on the right hand of God. And they went forth and preached everywhere, the Lord working with them and confirming the word with signs following. In other words, Jesus did not leave them. Jesus has not left us. He says, how long shall I be with you? And the Great Commission, he answers it. He says, and behold, I am with you to the end of the age. I'm not leaving you. The point of this passage is, without me, you can do nothing. But the good news is, with me, you can do everything, and I will never leave you. Our faith is not to be in faith. Our faith is to be in Christ, the mountain mover. The solution is not try to, with enough positive thinking and self-affirmation, believe enough to get whatever we want. The solution is come to Jesus. The solution is bring the problem to Jesus. The solution is he is the answer to everything that we face. And it doesn't mean we're not going to suffer, as Paul makes clear. But it means that we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. And so here, Jesus asked these two questions, and the answer to both of them, the first one is, how long shall I be with you? The answer is, to the end of the age, and then we shall ever be with the Lord. And the second one is, how long shall I be patient with you? And Peter, he answers this, it says, the Lord is patient with us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. The Lord is patient with us. I believe that what Jesus is doing is he's allowing them to see that their dependency has to be on him. They do not have this on their own. And so look at his next response here. He says, bring him to me. Bring him to me. Bring this boy to me. You've got a problem? The boy's, you think, lunatic? I know what the problem is. Bring him to me. It's not, okay, guys, once again, here's the seven steps and the right magic words to get rid of a demon. He doesn't do that. But what does he do? He says, bring him to me. You know what? The command stands. When we have a problem, bring it to Jesus. Bring the boy to Jesus. Look at verse 18. It says, and Jesus rebuked the devil, and he departed out of him, and the child was cured from that very hour. Now, we sing a song that that talks about how at the name of Jesus, every demon has to flee. Properly understood, that's true. But improperly understood, that's not true. The name of Jesus never has been, never will be, a magic word. That if you just say the name of Jesus, demons hate that sound so much. There's something about the phonics of Yeshua or Jesus that makes demons run. That's not what the Bible teaches. In fact, in the book of Acts, there's these guys, and they were supposed to be exorcists, but they weren't believers in the Lord Jesus. And they tried to, they're the seven sons of Sceva, and they said, we command you to leave in the name of Jesus whom Paul preaches. And they could not cast out the demon. In fact, the demons beat them up and they went running. Because the name Jesus is not a magic name. When the Bible tells us that we're to ask in his name, what he's saying is, you are, as a representative of me, you have authority in me, and because you're with me, you have power because you're acting according to my will. It's kind of like a person that has a steward, and the steward can write checks in the name of the person that sent them. And that's what we have. We have authority of Jesus if we are in relationship with Jesus. And so when we do things in the name of Jesus, we're doing it by his authority. The solution still is bring that kid to Jesus. Bring this problem to Jesus, because without him, we can do nothing. This is our role. Bring him to Jesus. Jesus is the Savior. Jesus is the Deliverer. Jesus is the Sanctifier. Jesus is the Healer. Bring him to Jesus. Listen to Isaiah 9:6. We quote the scripture a lot of times in the Christmas season. It says, "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace." He is the Mighty God, the Prince of Peace, Wonderful Counselor. And so he is the solution to our problems. The solution is not having the right formula or the magic words, open sesame. The solution is a person. He is the healer. He is the comforter. He is the counselor. He is the Mighty God. He says, "Bring him to me." Now, in verse 18, the fundamental cause, the immediate cause was, the child's crazy, but the fundamental cause is identified and remedied in verse 18. It says, "And Jesus rebuked the devil and departed out of him, and the child was cured from that very hour. Then came his disciples to Jesus apart and said, 'Why could not we cast him out?'" So, the problem with this child is not that he's necessarily lunatic. It's not caused by the moon. It's caused by a demon. And I want to talk about that for a moment, because we live in an age of skepticism, and a lot of people don't believe in demons or angels anymore. But a demon is a spirit, and a spirit is a person without a body. And in this case, the person who was crazy not because of a hormonal imbalance, not because of a baseball gave him a brain injury, but because there was a spirit, a person without a body, that was affecting him. The Bible never says that all mental disorders are caused by demons, but it is clear that some are. The Bible never says that all people who have epilepsy, it's the result of demons, or all people who have mental problems are caused by demons, but the Bible's clear that some are. Never says that all are. Sometimes things have physical causes. We are both physical and spiritual beings. Angels are merely spiritual beings. They are persons without bodies. They are not physical. They are not material. But we are both physical and spiritual. And sometimes our causes are physical. Sometimes the cause of a problem is the result of a brain injury, or the result of a chemical imbalance, a hormonal imbalance. If you eat the wrong herb, you can hallucinate. If you eat the right one, it might make you better. You say, "Well, I want scriptural proof of that." Okay, Psalm 104:14. "He causes the grass to grow for the cattle, and the herb for the service of man, that he may bring forth food out of the earth, and wine that maketh the heart glad, the heart of man, and oil to make his face to shine, and bread which strengtheneth man's heart." Now right there, he said herb is for the service of man. He says wine has a physiological effect on you, making your heart glad. And he said that bread strengthens not merely the body, but the heart. Inadequate nutrition, hormonal imbalance, eating the wrong things can have physiological, mental effects on us. You drink too much caffeine, you can't sleep. Now, is all lack of sleep caused by too much caffeine? No. In fact, sometimes it has a spiritual cause. I remember some years ago, I was having nightmares, and a lot of my friends in Bible school were having nightmares. We were losing sleep, and we were having these hideous dreams. Demonic dreams. And we're all standing out in the hallway and we're talking about this. And I said, this may have a spiritual cause, because we don't watch TV. We don't listen to music. We weren't listening to Megadeth before we went to bed. We weren't watching Halloween or Freddy Krueger or Jason or any of those things before we went to bed. And yet we're all having these dreams that are a very dark, scary nature. And some things were going on in the school, I think, of a spiritual nature. And it occurred to me we need to pray about this, because this could have a spiritual cause. About a year later, I thought, if it's just a matter of statistics, and a certain percentage of people have nightmares, then last year it seemed like all these guys were having nightmares, and this year I wonder if they're having nightmares. It ought to be the same percentage-wise, just maybe different people. So I went around, I started asking people, how are you sleeping? I'm sleeping like a baby. I'm sleeping great. And it occurred to me, you know what? I really think that had a spiritual cause, that there was a spiritual attack that was going on. And later on, I came to recognize that it's not normal for us as believers to have disturbed, frightening sleep. Psalm 4 says that he gives his beloved sleep. And so, if your child is waking up with nightmares every night, go to the Lord and say, Lord, what is the cause of this? Are you putting fearful things for their mind to think on before they go to bed? I've had different parents talk to me and say, you know what, my child is having these terrible demonic dreams. That's not normal. My children don't have demonic dreams. I pray over them before they go to bed. And I understand the reality that there are real unseen persons, demonic forces in the world that we have to do spiritual battle with. If you find yourself having very lustful dreams, dreams that have a very fearful, especially, you know, it's possible that it's what you're thinking about before you go to bed, what you're looking at on TV or the internet. But don't dismiss the possibility that it may have a spiritual cause. Ephesians 6 says we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against spirits and rulers of this world, princes of darkness. There are real forces at work, and knowing what the cause is determines how we deal with it. Now, if on the other hand, you're abusing your body, you're not eating properly, you're overworking or you're undersleeping and you're having physical problems, and the solution is changing your schedule or changing your diet or changing something you're drinking, and you go around casting out the devil, it's not going to do you any good because the devil isn't the cause of the problem. The problem is what you're eating, what you're thinking on, physiological. But on the other hand, if you are trying to deal with a spiritual problem with physical means, that's not going to do any good either. We wrestle, the Bible's very clear that demons exist. Regardless of the problem, we bring it to Jesus. We ask him for wisdom. We say, Lord, is this physical or is this spiritual? I remember one time a friend of mine was sick, and I went out to pray, and I was like, Lord, this is just odd the way it came on. I was having nightmares at night. I was waking up in drenched clothing, and it was just very unlike me. I don't have nightmares. So whenever I start having them, I wonder about it. And out of nowhere, my friend gets sick, and as I was praying, I felt it was revealed to me in prayer that this had a spiritual cause. This was not merely physical. There was a spiritual cause to it. And so I started to pray intently as if it was a spiritual force that I was dealing with, rebuking the devil, confessing my sin, bringing myself in submission to God, because the Bible says, submit yourselves to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. So the first thing we do in spiritual warfare is we submit ourselves to God. God, do I have any sin in my life that is hindering you from working through me? Because if I regard iniquity in my heart, he will not hear me. If I don't dwell with my wife with understanding, if I have unconfessed sin with her, very clearly, 1 Peter 3 says, my prayers will be hindered. So what's the first thing we do? We submit ourselves to God. We say, God, what is the, I want to confess my sin to you. I want to submit myself to you. And once we're submitted to God, then we can resist the devil. So I started rebuking the evil force that was at work. And you know what? Someone else was praying for my friend at the same time that this was going on, and he was immediately healed. Immediately healed. But before I was even done praying, it's like the words just quit. And it's like, I just knew it in my heart. God just did something. And he did at that very time. I had the confirmation in my spirit, this is done. So we wrestle against evil forces. And there's an evil force at work here. And because of their doubt, because of their disbelief, they could not cast him out. We have to be able to identify what the cause is, and then we deal with it accordingly. I've known a lot of people, though, that, you know, they've got a very obviously, their problem is caused by sin or from bad habits, and the wisdom is there to deal with it, but they don't want the wisdom. They would rather try to cast out devils and use magic phrases than repent of the way that they're eating or drinking or living, and as a result, they're not getting the results. And then they're wondering, why isn't God heal me of this. Okay, so look now with me at, again, verses 19 and 20. It says, then came the disciples to Jesus apart and said, why could not we cast him out? And Jesus said unto them, because of your unbelief. Now I want you to notice that first of all. He says the root cause of your inability to deal with this is a lack of faith, your unbelief. Not a lack of desire, not a lack of will, not a lack of effort, intelligence, or organizational skills, or financial funding. Their problem is a lack of faith. The root cause of their inability is, or the immediate cause is a lack of faith. And he goes on and he says, if you have faith as a grain of mustard seed, you shall say unto this mountain, remove hence to yonder place, and it shall remove, and nothing shall be impossible unto you. So he says, your problem here is a lack of faith. Now, what is faith? Faith in the Strong's, the Greek word pistis, means assurance, is translated as assurance, belief, faith, and fidelity. But the best definition is taken from Hebrews 11:1. It says in King James, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. I like the NASB. It says, now faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. You lack the conviction of things not seen. At this moment, you're trying to deal with this demon, and you guys are unable to because you don't have that inner conviction that that demon is going to leave when you command him out. And he says, if you have enough assurance, you can say to this mountain, be thou removed, and be thou cast into the sea. Now, can you remember which passage mentions Jesus going around and moving mountains? Is there one? Can you think of passages where Jesus just said, hey, you know what, just for the fun of it, I'm going to move the mountain? You know what, if there was a mountain in Jesus' way and it was necessary, I'm sure he would have moved the mountain. In fact, there's a lot of times in the Old Testament, you know, the Red Sea opens up and they walked through it, and Jesus did walk on water. I think that's equal to moving mountains. That's pretty impressive. Why does he say this when we don't have any illustration in any of the apostles or anybody else, just for the fun of it, walking outside and saying, mountain be moved. Wow, that was cool. Never do it. In fact, we see times where Paul tells Timothy, have a little wine for your stomach's sake. And I used to read that and be like, well, man, Paul, you're an apostle. Why don't you just say in the name of Jesus, be healed? You know, why did you say, you know what? Sounds like you're drinking some bad water, Timothy. You need something you need to take a little wine for your stomach's sake. Paul didn't walk around and just for the coolest of it say, oh, look, I've got faith. I'm an apostle. Watch me lift this car and move it over to the other side of the street. He doesn't do that. And yet many people take it that way. They take it as, you know what? Faith is a magical force, and if you can just master the formula, you can have everything that you want in the world. And yet we don't see this as really happening in Scripture. And yet Jesus is very clear, if you have faith as the grain of mustard seed, you can say to this mountain, be thou removed and be thou cast in the sea, and it shall be done unto you. So what's at issue here? Well, I tell you what I find rather puzzling in the passage, or did. Now I think I'm getting an answer to it. But it's so interesting that he says faith as a grain of mustard seed, which the mustard seed, as we know from other places in the Bible, was considered, at least metaphorically, to be the smallest of the seeds. So if we're emphasizing its smallness, it's almost like saying, oh, all you need is a very, very little bit of faith and you can move mountains. And yet Paul, referring to moving mountain faith, refers to it as an illustration of the greatest type of faith. For example, listen to this. In 1 Corinthians 13:1-2, listen to what it says. Though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels and have not love, I am become a sounding brass or a tinkling cymbal. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I could remove mountains and have not charity, I am nothing. Now here he doesn't say a little bit of faith so that I can move mountains. He says all faith so that I can move mountains. And he's definitely quoting or alluding to what Jesus said in this passage. And I would point out to you that it's probably not the smallness of the great grain of mustard seed that Jesus is alluding to. It is small. Another place he mentions too how it's the smallest of seeds and yet it grows into the largest of herbs. But just think about how amazing a mustard seed is. You've got this little bitty seed and you put it in the dirt and it could have been dried out and sitting for years. I heard of wheat being found in Pharaoh's tomb and they took it and they planted it and it actually grew wheat from it. For thousands of years, it's been in a tube. It's been dry. It's been left alone. You think if there's any life in it, it would be dead. And yet they add water, and wheat grows from it. Isn't that amazing? Seeds are amazing. And I think he's saying something here about the nature of faith. A living, active faith, under the right conditions, it produces. Look at how it produces. When that seed comes in contact with dirt and a little water is added and moisture, it fulfills its destiny that was programmed into it, into its very DNA. And he's saying, you know what, if you've got the faith of a mustard seed, you can say unto this mountain, be thou removed and cast in the sea, and it shall be done unto you. And you know what, if you're living in the will of God, and you're doing his purpose, and he has a job for you to do, and you have faith, it will be done. But it's Jesus who's going to do it. The Bible never says that we can ask according to our lusts and get whatever we want. But rather, if we are communing with God and we're walking with God, then his purposes are going to be fulfilled in us. That seed designed by God has the information that takes dirt and makes it into a tree. That's marvelous. That is amazing. DNA. The code is written in that seed. You put it in the earth and it produces. In the right conditions, it produces. And Jesus says, if we have faith of a grain of mustard seed, we can ask what we will and it shall be done unto you. We never see the apostles going around and using their faith for simply self-advancement. But as they commune with God and walk with God, God works with them and his will is done in their life. Now, faith actually is not something that we can simply drum up ourselves anyway. Let me look at another, right before the 1 Corinthians 13 passage. It calls faith a gift, as something that God gives. In fact, 1 Corinthians 13 referred to the gift of faith that can move mountains. Look at 1 Corinthians 12:1. You don't have to turn there. I'll just read it to you. He says, now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I would not have you ignorant. He says in verse 4, now there are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. And there are differences of administrations, but the same Lord. And there are diversities of operations, but it is the same God which works all in all. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man to profit everyone. For to one is given by the Spirit the word of wisdom, to another the word of knowledge by the same Spirit, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another the gifts of healing by the same Spirit, to another the working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another discerning of spirits, to another diverse kinds of tongues, to another the interpretation of tongues. But all these works that one and the selfsame Spirit, dividing to every man severally as he will. I have people that I have known that I believe had the gift of faith. My aunt, she was here last Sunday, and you ever have a chance to sit down and talk to her? She's a woman that I think has the gift of faith, gift of miracles. She's had many miracles happen to her in her life. My grandmother was the same way. She was a woman that you could sit down with her, and she could tell you for hours about dramatic healings and things that had happened to her, and God gave her. Now, I want to tell you what, when my grandmother died of cancer, she prayed very vehemently not to die of cancer. She believed very strongly, I'm going to be healed of cancer. She still died. And yet there were times where she was praying and she felt led to go pray for somebody and they were healed. And it was marvelous to hear that. It was incredible. She had some incredible gifts. My great-grandfather was another one who had the gift of faith. He couldn't control it whenever he wanted, but God would put faith in him and he'd pray for somebody and they would be healed. He lived in a little town in Missouri, and people would rather bring, people oftentimes, instead of going to the doctor, would go to him because he was a man that God gave miracles to many times. It was a gift. It was a gift. Times when I've seen someone healed, and I haven't had anything as dramatic as some of it, but there's been a couple times I've seen people healed, and as I was praying, it's like faith just came, and the miracle happened. I can't control that at a will. You know what? God is not your genie. People want to make Jesus into a genie. Jesus is not a genie. He is the sovereign God. He gives the gift to whomsoever he wills. That's what it says. The Spirit, in 1 Corinthians 12:11, but all these worketh that one and selfsame Spirit, dividing to every man as he will. As he will. God has his purposes. He will accomplish them how he wants in his time. Our job is not to have faith in faith. It's to have faith in Christ. To have faith in his Spirit, knowing that he can do as he will. And when the Lord has ordained a miracle to happen, it happens. You read church history? Church history is the history of miracles. Whether you're talking about the early church or the Reformation or the period of time of gospel expansion in the Middle Ages, God worked miracles. You read the history of St. Patrick, God worked miracles through St. Patrick, through St. Basil, through various men, miraculous deliverances, word of knowledge, word of wisdom is mentioned in 1 Corinthians 12. And it's in all sorts of denominations. People that loved Christ were serving Christ, and God gives as he will. Listen to 1 Corinthians again, chapter 12, verse 27. He says, now ye are the body of Christ, and members in particular. And God hath sent some in the church, first apostles, secondarily prophets, thirdly teachers, after that miracles, then gifts of healings, helps, governments, diversities of tongues. Are all apostles? Are all prophets? Are all teachers? Are all workers of miracles? Have all the gifts of healing? Do all speak with tongues? Do all interpret? But covet earnestly the best gifts, and yet I show unto you a more excellent way. And what follows is the 1 Corinthians 13 love chapter. He says love is the more excellent way. And yet he does say covet earnestly the best gifts. But he makes it very clear. Not all people have the faith to move mountains. And some people want to use this scripture almost to beat up Christ's church and say there's something seriously wrong with you. Now there may be something seriously wrong with us. I think it's legit. He says to covet earnestly the best gifts. We should be seeking Christ. We should be crying out to Christ. We ought to be crying out for revival. We ought to be crying out for the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. We ought to be seeking him. We ought to be asking for the salvation of the lost. We ought to be asking for the reformation of our nation. We ought to be seeking him, asking him, God, let your will be done in this place, believing for great things. But have all the gifts of miracles? Clearly, Paul says, nope. Covet the best gifts, but most of all, covet Christ. Seek Christ. And then in verse 21, he says something else. So the immediate cause is a lack of faith, but then in verse 21, he says something else. He says, howbeit, this kind goeth not out, but by prayer and fasting. Now you pair that with what Paul says in 1 Corinthians 12, saying to covet earnestly the best gifts. And I think sometimes what it is God doesn't want to give us an immediate response to our prayers. He wants us to pray vehemently and earnestly like Elijah did. James chapter 5, it says that Elijah was a man of like passions as we are. In other words, he struggled with depression. We read about it. He probably struggled with vanity. He may have struggled with lust. He may have struggled with his tongue or anger, temper. He was a man of like passions as we are, and yet he prayed earnestly that it might not rain on the earth by the space of 3 years and 6 months, and it rained not. He prayed again, and the heaven gave forth rain, and the earth brought forth fruit. Now, James 5, the point of James 5 is not, well, Elijah was so much greater than us. Of course he could do miracles, but you people can't. No, the point of James 5 is, you know what? Elijah was just like you and me. He struggled with sin. He struggled with depression. May have struggled with a whole host of sins. But he was a man that prayed earnestly. He coveted the best gifts. He sought God. And God gave him his request. Luke 18, Jesus gives a parable. And he tells us at the beginning that the Luke tells us why this parable was given. That men ought always to pray and not to faint. The purpose of the parable is that men ought always to pray and not to faint. And then he gives the parable of this little widow woman, and she goes to an unjust judge who doesn't fear God and he doesn't fear men, and she asks something, and he says no. And so the next day she goes back. I have a request. Give me justice. No. I have a request. Give me justice. And she wearied him with her asking day and night. And finally, though he feared neither God nor man, he said, fine, just so you'll leave me alone, take it. Get away. And then Jesus says, how much more will your heavenly Father answer those that will call him upon him? He says, yes, speedily, speedily. But the point of the parable was that men ought always to pray and not to faint. So on one hand, I don't want you to feel guilty if your gift isn't gift of miracles, okay? But on the other hand, there is a point to this passage that we ought to be praying and seeking God to work with us. We ought to be seeking Christ because Christ is the mountain mover. He says, this kind cometh not out, but by prayer and fasting. Prayer and fasting. Seeking God, communion with God. Jesus was perfect. He was the Son of God. He was the Son of Man. And yet we're told that he rose a great while before day to seek God in prayer. As a pattern to us, that we ought to be a people that are seeking God continually. When Jesus said, ask and ye shall receive. Seek and ye shall find. Knock and it shall be opened unto you. For everyone that asketh receiveth, and he that seeketh findeth, and to him that knocketh it shall be opened. When he says ask, seek, knock, that the word believe in Greek is really keep asking, keep seeking, keep knocking. Because your Father in heaven isn't a sin nature Father. He is a perfect heavenly Father who loves to give his children spiritual gifts. He loves to give his children bread. If you ask for bread, he's not going to give you a stone. But you got to keep asking. You got to keep seeking. You got to keep knocking. Now, if we don't have faith, guess what? We'll give up. Because the flesh doesn't like to pray. The flesh says it's a waste of time to pray. The flesh says, let's do something more practical. Let's have a fund drive. Let's do something practical. Let's get organized. Let's do something practical. Let's study. Let's do a Google search. Because prayer to the natural man seems like a waste of time. And yet Jesus says, listen, you want to do great things with God and for God? Seek me, ask me, seek me, knock until it's opened unto you. And so he said, this kind goeth not out, but by prayer and fasting. It's not a magic word that makes the demon leave. It's power with God. It's power with God. So, Jesus says that the Son of Man, in verse 22, shall be betrayed into the hands of men, and they shall kill him, and the third day he shall be raised again. This phrase, Son of Man, is a very interesting phrase. I told you before that the reason Jesus speaks in the third person here and the reason he speaks of the Son of Man is because of its prophetic significance. This came right after the passage of the Transfiguration. If you ever read Daniel 7, it's one of those great passages that talk about the glory cloud and talk about a vision of God and where he's glowing and he's like fire and white wool and all of that language. But listen to Daniel 7:13. Daniel says, I saw in the night visions, and behold, one like the Son of Man came with the clouds of heaven and came to the Ancient of Days. And they brought him near before him. And there was given to him dominion and glory and a kingdom that all people, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion which shall not pass away, and his kingdom that which shall not be destroyed. When Jesus comes in the clouds in that passage, he's not coming down, he's coming up. He's coming up to the Ancient of Days. And Daniel says he was given a kingdom. It'll be an eternal kingdom that will never be destroyed. When the disciples see Jesus leave, how do they see him leave? He goes up in the clouds. I think the disciples saw him going up in the clouds. Daniel sees him coming up in the clouds. And there he came up to the Ancient of Days. He receives a kingdom. A kingdom that all men and all nations should serve him everywhere. So when Jesus says the Son of Man will suffer at Jerusalem, There's passages that refer to the Son of Man. And there's victorious passages that refer to the Son of Man. And what he's really doing there is he's saying, you know what? I'm going to suffer, but that's not the end of it. I will be raised the third day. What do they hear? They hear, I'm going to suffer. What should we hear? The Son of Man is at the right hand of the Father. He has commissioned his church to proclaim the gospel in all nations. He has given us a job to do. And he has said, I will be with you always. So when we read in Mark 16, that after the Lord had spoken unto them, he was received up into heaven and sat on the right hand of God. And they went forth and preached everywhere, the Lord working with them, confirming the words with signs following. It's concluded with, Amen, so be it. We have a job to do. He said he would work with us. He said he would confirm his word to us and through us. So while not all men have the gift of faith, we do have a living Savior. And we should seek him. That's our job, is to seek him, that he might work in us and to us and through us. If God has a job for us to do, then he has the power to perform that job. And the emphasis of this passage is our faith is not to be in faith, it's to be in Jesus. It's to be in Jesus, the mountain mover. I think you see a couple times, you see in the fact that he says, how long shall I be with you? And then we have a phrase, bring him to me. And then we read that when they heard that he would be taken from them, though for a short time, they were in despair. The emphasis of this passage is Jesus. Not a faith formula, it's Jesus. If we will seek the Son will work with us. He will work in us. He will work through us. That's the emphasis. Bring it to Jesus. Seek the Son, and his will be accomplished in our life. So, as a practical issue, are we coveting the best gifts? Are we daring to ask God for great things? You know, we look around and we see some really bad things happening in the culture. We see the rise of paganism. We see such anti-Christian behavior, and there's fear all around us. But, you know, there were a lot of fearful things going on in the first century when Christians were being roasted over gridirons. When they were being set, they were being made into candlesticks for Nero's chariot races. And it's so easy for people to get caught up and saying, oh, the world's getting so bad, and withdraw from the world. But you realize, we're the church. We've been given the Great Commission. We've been given the Holy Spirit. And Jesus said, come to me and believe in me. Dare to believe for great things. God can turn around things like that. Our God created the mountains. It's not a big deal for him to move them. If we will trust in him and we will seek him, cry out to him, we can expect great things in our generation. Will we dare to do it? Will we dare to cry out for him? The one who loved us and gave himself for us will answer his elect speedily. Let's pray this morning. Oh, Heavenly Father, I come before you, Lord, and I pray that you would bring revival to our generation. God, you've given us a life to live, and it's like a cloud that arises above the waters and the sun comes out and it disappears. Our life is but a vapor. And Lord, I want to see you do great things in our generation. I want to see you do great things in our community, in our church. Father, I pray that you would increase our faith. I pray that you would give us faith, not in faith, but in the one who gives the gift of faith, the author and the finisher of our faith. We look unto Jesus this morning. Looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, we cry out to you, and I pray that your will would be done in this body, that you would provoke us, Lord, to good works, that we would trust you to do great things, and that you would do them. Lord, I pray that you'd pour out your Spirit upon us, that you'd give gifts to your body, and that you would do your will in us and through us. God, there's such great needs in our community, in our times. Father, we come and we ask you to increase our faith and to bring us into your perfect will. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen.